future of news. A star-studded lineup. I'm going to introduce the panelists to you one by one while the chairs are being arranged. First up is Binoy Prabhakar, executive editor of Moneycontrol. He's the founding editor of CNBC TV 18 and a fellow at the Tau Knight Center for Entrepreneurial Journalism in New York. Before this, he was senior editor at The Economic Times. Give a big round of applause while we invite Binoy to come up on stage, please. Next up is Durga Raghunath, head of news partnerships at Google. She's earlier the digital head of Times of India, senior vice president of growth at Zomato, and CEO of Indian Express Digital. That's one heck of a resume. Thank you so much, Durga, for coming. All of these speakers have really taken their time out to travel from across Indian cities. Let's make them really feel good. Let's give Durga one more round of applause. Yeah, thank you. Up next is Naresh Fernandes, editor of Scroll.in. Interesting tidbit, he graduated from the Columbia Journalism School. It's considered to be the Harvard of journalism, very difficult to get in. In fact, Columbia chooses only one Indian for that year, and yeah. So in the year he joined, he actually beat Barka to that spot. And then Barka came the next year and rejoined them. So interesting fact. Next, I'd like to invite Navaneeth. Navaneeth, the CEO of the Hindu Group, GM. He was earlier the general manager of advertising and marketing in the Hindu Group in an earlier stint. Clearly the guy who knows the numbers game, so it'll be very interesting to have Navaneeth. He has 2 decades of experience, and here's the interesting part, right? So he's worked in publishing, he's worked in radio, in TV, and in media agency. Remarkable 360-degree view of the industry. It's fantastic. So thank you so much, Navaneeth, for joining in. The first round is going to be a very straightforward, sharp question. The panel is called The Future of News. In under 3 minutes, Binoy, if you were to look into the crystal ball, what do you think is the future of news?
Yeah, so I work for a publisher named Moneycontrol. I really hope you guys are familiar with it. Moneycontrol is a publication that is focused on the stock market, business, and economy. News moves markets, and we do a lot of stories, you know, a lot of content that help make the financial decision of our audience easier. And that's our loyal audience that we really, you know, serve them very well. But in recent years, we also found that there is an audience that is not so much interested in the financial news. These are folks that are interested in health and fitness, overseas education, electric vehicles. So what we do is now, you know, we've amplified our coverage. We've expanded into new beats. We write about startups in tech. We write about health. We write about fitness. We write about drinks. We write about culture. We write about art. We pretty much write about every topic under the sun. We write about the sun also, by the way. So our approach has been that we try to serve what our audience really wants. For example, we're just going to, you know, hire a reporter who's going to be entirely focused on writing about AI, because that seems to be the whole hot topic these days. And our, you know, it's about, you know, addressing, you know, questions that really matter to our audience, and helping them, you know, understand, connect the dots better. So that's our approach with this thing. I'll just give you one example. And in formats that they prefer, because a year ago, we had a very negligible presence in videos. And then we found that, you know, there is an audience that really prefers watching, you know, having, you know, absorbing content in that format. And we, today we do 5 live shows. We produce about 3 to 4 videos. And you know, last month, you know, with Facebook and YouTube, we had about 13 million views. So we've come a long way. We're not so big on newsletters, but we still thought, okay, there is, especially in the startup and tech world, there are people who prefer getting, you know, reading that in a newsletter. So we have a newsletter there, and that is going to be our approach for future of news, to do things, to continue innovate and address topics, answer questions that really matter to our audience. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Binoy. Durga, you have a ringside view with your area of expertise, so future of news.
Yeah, no, sure. So I think where perhaps because of my sort of checkered experience across media as well as where I sit right now, I'm able to, I think, get a zoomed out view of the ecosystem. And just a couple of interesting things, right? So I think language has come up as a theme earlier on today, and I'll say it again. I think every month, you know, you're seeing an exponential increase in language users accessing the internet. And I think the whole way in which we create content and do journalism as a result of all these new users coming on the mobile internet especially, I think is going to throw up a lot of new models, right? I think we've seen some bilingual models, but I think this whole idea of bilingual, multilingual is going to undergo a lot of innovation and change over the next 5 years or so, not merely from a translation perspective, but I think a modern interpretation of it as well, right? Like for young people, format-wise, access-wise, and so on. Second, I think, you know, the story, I mean, Binoy talked a little bit about what are the new beats, you know, the way you're covering things. I think the kernel of the story, which is always the starting point of a lot of the news business and always has been, I think it's also undergoing a lot of change. And I think formats, short, long, multimedia, you're seeing very different formats emerge. So that's something, again, that I feel will start becoming, much more experimental than what we've seen in the past. The third sort of trend I'd like to call out is, just paying for news, right? I think 10 years ago, there were probably 5 startups. Scroll was one of those startups. And today, we have about 150 startups we work with. Super interesting across different kinds of, very deep niches, as well as single bylines, small group of journalists. So very many models where I think niches and expertise are coming back into focus, and there is a direct relationship with the writer, and the byline is as important as the brand. And finally, and I'll sort of end with this, I think that, you know, loyalty and what it means to the young user versus the more mature news user, I think is also something that each newsroom will have to build for. I think the young are not loyal. I don't know what the elegant way of putting it is, but you know, they move from one thing to the other. They're loyal to culture and their friends, but I don't believe they're necessarily loyal to a brand till much later, right? So I think we're thinking of news brands. We'll have to think of news brands that are loyal to our older readers, and by that I don't mean just older in terms of chronology, but just have been with a news brand, as against never letting go of the young user whom you want to fall in love with news as well, right? So I think both those are not necessarily dichotomies, but can have strategies for both within a news brand.
Got Naresh? It. Thank you, Durga. Naresh?
Thanks. Good afternoon. If you visited my hometown of Bombay, you'll know that one of our city's most iconic structures is the Rajabhai Clock Tower. But not so many people realize that the structure was financed by the man who was in the middle of India's first stock market crash in 1865. The Rajabhai Clock Tower, to me, is also a reminder of the value of speedy, accurate information. Premchand Roychand, the guy who paid for its construction, was involved in many ventures, chief of which was trading cotton. At that time, the price of the white gold, as it was called, was soaring in India because Britain's traditional supplier in the US was in the middle of a civil war. And the price of cotton in India soared, and it was determined by the price at which this commodity was traded in London. And every few days, the ships would come out bringing the latest cotton prices. It wasn't just snail mail, it was sail mail. And Premchand Roychand, according to some historians, sent out small, fast boats into the harbor. And he would get the prices in advance from the captains of those of the ships that were bringing in the mail. And this allowed him to game the local market. He used his fortune to buy his way into reclamation companies and onto the boards of the city's biggest banks. When the Civil War ended, the price of cotton in India plummeted and took many Indian businessmen down with them. Premchand, Roychand, hardest of them all. Ever since the birth of the modern press in the 19th century, we've operated on the premise that access to information is power and worked on the assumption that our readers and our audiences really value that. Ironically, as internet technology now allows us to access information almost instantly, increasing numbers of people are turning away from the news. All this breaking news, it seems, is actually pushing the news industry to breaking point. According to the latest digital news report of the Reuters Institute at Oxford, the proportion of news consumers who say they avoid news sometimes or often has increased sharply across countries. This type of news avoidance has actually doubled in countries as dissimilar as Brazil, where it now stands at 54%, and the UK, where it's 46%. Some people aren't just avoiding news, they're actually disassociating themselves from the news. The respondents to the survey gave many reasons for why they're unplugging. They said they feel worn out by too much news, that they don't trust journalists, that the news brings down their mood, or that it leads to a feeling of powerlessness because they aren't sure what they can do with the information that they've been given. A significant proportion of younger and less educated people say they avoid the news because it's hard or difficult to follow. How we deal with this, I think, will be crucial. The innovative formats we find to deliver the news and vital contextual information to an increasingly exhausted audience will determine not just, I think, the future of the news industry, it will determine the health of our democracy. If we fail to find compelling answers, we'll crash and burn, just like Premchand Roychand and the Bombay investors a century and a half ago.
Great. Fantastic. Great analogy, great storytelling. Thanks for that, Naresh. Really appreciate it. Thank you. Navaneeth?
Thanks, Kirubha. I think the future of news is very exciting. The future of the news business is very complex. Two different things. I think a lot of answers to the future lies in the past itself. When we look at our business, I say a significant part of future lies in our past. Because you go back to the past, looked at what news companies did very well. Credible, trustworthy, authentic, fact-checked. The Bangalore Watch Company spoke about some of this. And this has stood us in good time, and we have seen evidence of people coming to trusted news sources, especially during COVID. That will not change. And I think a lot of our past is context. Companies that have been around for a long time. For instance, we are 144 years old. Manoramaonline is also a very old company. What we really have is a lot of context. And context, when presented well, is you're making sense of what's happening today, using the learnings of yesterday, and telling readers what the implications of choices we make today for future generation are. So a lot of the future lies in the past. But the news business itself is complex. The variables at play are, how do you increase efficiency in your business? How do you increase loyalty? She touched upon it. How do you increase engagement? And finally, how do you build scale in the business? Multiple things at play, but I think the future of news and future of news business is going to be multi-format, multimedia and multi-language. It needs a balance of creation and curation, and it also needs you to deal with what sound like oxymorons by looking at the business side. To my mind, the future will be more reader revenue than advertiser revenue. Today, it's largely advertiser revenue driven. But to pivot to a business model where reader revenue is higher, while you're chasing the advertising revenue, you need to look at width of content for the advertising business. You need to look at depth of content for the reader business. In the advertising business, you typically write for the least common multiple. For the subscription business, you target the highest common factor. Complex, but an exciting time to be in the industry of news and the business of news.
Thank you. Thank you. You know, there was this user experience test that was done where they asked about some 3,000 people to read newspapers and then a few thousand people to browse news websites. And they fixed a camera to check what's the behavior like when they were reading newspapers. And they found that almost always people create a habit and they go to a particular section in a newspaper or a particular section in a website because that's all they care about. And it's about 4% of the entire news is what is relevant to one particular audience, which means 96% is not relevant to the person who's reading that. So would the future of news be then contextual, where you understand every individual is a reader by himself or herself, and the news is created only to match the interest? Do you see that ever happening at all, or would it just be spray and pray?
So again, I think it's where you seek the news also. I think those, from what I've seen, I think the app is the newspaper 2.0, right, in my mind, because it's this lovely mix of navigation that has been cracked in a good way. So there's push and there is pull, right? So there's search, there's discovery, and there is excellent navigation that you can design for. And there's a certain amount of personalization, right? But when you go into a search engine or when you look at a social media feed, in search engines, there's a clear intent, right? You're saying you're looking for something, you're seeking news. Again, it's push, right? Pull. Whereas with social media, you're looking at this whole vast, endless stream of news and you're choosing something. So you kind of travel where the internet or social media platform takes you. So I feel that, you know, there are different mindsets or states of mind where you're seeking certain things. And I think the morning habit is different from the afternoon catch up, which is different from the night read, right? And I think there are product experiences for each of those. And I think when you think of a diversified media approach, it's for me, sure, audio, video, text, blah, blah. But I think it's also behavioral, right, in my mind, that you have to have an app experience that's a morning push like a newspaper experience. You have to have an afternoon catch up, which could be a mailer, and you have to have an evening special read or something, right? Where you're bringing the user back, you're creating that habit and focusing on loyalty.
Got it. Thank you, Durga.
I'll just add to that. So again, taking up from our experience, so we have these conversations with, with our readers, that we have a very agile customer engagement team. But personally, some of these readers I engage with, and there is this a very big investor. I'm sure the gentleman wouldn't want to, reveal his name. He manages a huge portfolio of companies, so he's very familiar with the money control, the product side. In terms of, how the portfolio pages look like. How the stock data pages look like, and gives this, why is this not downloadable in Excel format? You should give the option of turning it automatically into a PDF, because I like to automatically send it, I'd like to save it. So he used to give this kind of, feedback. And just the other day, he told me that, I heard that you guys offer your subscribers access to the Financial Times. But I'm not able to find that. Where is that in the app? No, this is a chap who's been using Moneycontrol for years, and Financial Times, we've been, it's been with us for the last more than 2 years. And it got us thinking. That means, we really need to do better in terms of providing discoverability of our content. And that's something that we are working on.
Got it. Thank you. So we have two editors on the panel, and then we have a business person. I would put Durga and Navaneeth in the same. So there are two business folks, two editors on the panel. And usually in a news organization, you want to keep the business and news a little apart, a wall in between, so that always keep the church and the state separate. However, it's very interesting. I was traveling in the car with Naresh, and we were talking about, and one important thing is ensuring that the business succeeds, it survives, thrives. And Durga mentioned about 140-plus new startups that are coming in. So how do these businesses survive or even thrive without mixing ad sales with editorial content? In other words, how can you stop people from buying news coverage?
So I think the primary source that drives your audience to your news is your credibility. And when you begin to play footsie with the people on the other side of the wall, your reader is the first person to know that. Mm. And that destroys your credibility, which destroys your, to use your business jargon, sort of value proposition. And so it is in your own interest, in your best interest, to keep that wall.
Got it. Thank you. Navaneeth, Hindu has always been known to be a stellar, like a beacon for doing exactly that. But is it, Hindu can get away with that, but what about smaller companies? What would be your experience?
See, our view is they should never be mixed. So for instance, our entire business runs around our purpose, and purpose is common to everybody in the company, whether you're a journalist or not. We have massive respect for our journalists. So always say my job is to make our journalists succeed. It's very clear. The product is run by journalists. Our vision is held by us together. Our views are articulated through the newspaper, which is true to our journalistic values. So there's no interference, and in the long run, it's a very good way to build the business. However, while that interference shouldn't be there, and there shouldn't be a wall, but there should be a thin line. You cannot build businesses without editors and business people working together.
Mm.
So insights from consumers, what readers need, our feedback that editors are open to, and that is something the business generates. So there we have a common view, but clearly the role of content lies with editors, and we are very proud of what they do. And because you are proud of what they do, you would do nothing that would make their status in society come down, because readers can sense it before we can. So,
yeah.
So just to sort of add, I think when advertising was the only game in town, I think there was a very clear wall between the two, and for very good reasons, in terms of making sure that space for one doesn't compromise the space for the other, and choices aren't made in terms of coverage and so on. But I think in the subscription first era, at least, I think we are seeing a lot of startups where editors are founders, right? So I think the Ken is a good example of a subscription first product where you have a team that where most people do most things, and they're a very entrepreneurial team. And I'm sure every model has pluses and minuses, but I think an interesting trend that I'm definitely seeing is the editor as the CEO and the editor as the founder. Again, which goes back to my point of putting the story at the heart of the relationship. And I think that might lead to interesting models or interpretations of this relationship.
Interesting. Thank you, Durga.
Yeah. So I'll just echo what Navaneeth said, actually. So, see, to state the obvious, the news business is really tough, right? So the media needs to make money. And why the news business, sometimes struggle is that there are folks who at the business side had absolutely no clue what the journalists are doing. The journalists had absolutely no idea what the business side is doing. So collaboration is absolutely important. You know, everyone should be in this, on the same page, but clearly with rules that, you know, the rules of engagement are clear, the disclosures to the audience is clear, and that, you know, there are certain no-go areas from the business side.
Got it. Thank you. You can't miss out and escape on what's been of in recent news, which is BBC facing the fire and the ire for the documentary. So I want to use that as a context to say, future of news is super important. I think the powers that be want to control news. So how does a news organization be true to itself, true to its DNA, without being fearful of the power factor? Naresh, would you, scroll.in is one that is not afraid to say the truth. So,
You know that line that Nike used to use, just do it. I think that's what.
But what about the repercussions? You know, there has been, because of the recent raids, there are lots of other organizations that have scaled back on the criticism, is what we've been hearing. And I know that you mentioned that the government uses, or the powers that be use a certain. So do you want to talk to us about that experience of how it's easy to pull people into long-winded court litigations and stuff? You want to talk about that?
So yeah, as we know, several of our colleagues have been jailed. Siddiq Kappan from this state being one of the prime examples. And then you have sort of lesser degrees of engagement, shall we say, long-running tax evasion charges. And given that the financial system is so complicated, it could be quite easy to tie somebody down on one specific point. But then you shouldn't be in the news business if you don't have the stomach for battle. And this is not just about our industry. This is a battle for the survival of our democracy. If citizens do not get the information they need in order to make informed choices, and increasingly they're not, then you shouldn't call yourself a news company. You should call yourself a media company.
Got it. Thank you. Thank you for that honesty. What about, so Durga, you mentioned about Ken as an example, and there's a new business model coming in where you're not reliant on advertisers, and hence the concept of let me get higher eyeballs, let me get bigger circulation to impress the advertisers goes away. And you're looking at a very small but niche, almost fan-like following for your site. Is that the way forward?
No, I think that the mass media function of news does remain, right? Like, I think when you have, like the Hindu, whom, you know, Google works with very closely as well, they have a strong print presence, they have a strong digital presence, they have a strong app presence, so and they have huge trust with the community, right? So similarly, Malayalam Manorama, right? Global, Malayali, great platform. So I think there are lots of options for integrated brand advertising, which none of these media companies will and should give up, right? So I think when you're an integrated media company with years of trust and a strong relationship, there are lots of advertising gains. But today, if I were personally, you know, starting over again and I was thinking about news, I don't believe I would choose anything but subscription as the direct relationship that I would like to have with the user. And build that relationship from scratch across not everything, but a very specialized sort of approach to users who might be interested in that area, right? So I think that's an easier model for startups to adopt at this point in time than to go after the ad model, which at least in digital parlance is still a very mass media model.
Got it. Thank you, Durga. Thank you.
Yeah, so see, I think the key here is experimentation. So the Ken, when it started, they made a big deal about writing one story a day, right? Now they are into newsletters. They said it's subscription, so you're not going to see ads. They're now experimenting with ads. And I think that's the right approach, because you can't continue with one model and not experiment, because readers' preferences, their choices, everything changes, their habits change, right? And again, I'm not saying anything original here, but successful media companies, the ones that truly make money, they don't rely on one single business model. They rely on subscriptions. We do. Until 3 years ago, we never had a subscription model. Today, 35% of our revenues come from subscription. We have more than 600,000 subscribers for Moneycontrol Pro, which is a paywall product. Display continues to be one of our big advertisers. We've just started going big with events. So I think the key is to continue experimenting, look at new ways to make money, new ways to engage with the audience. Yeah, that's the way forward.
Got it. Thank you. Navaneeth, there's a question for you from Jitin Babu. Jitin, do you want to raise your hands if you are around? Thank you. So Jitin says, do you think in the next 5 years, news will only be in video/audio format, given that 5G and 6G will eventually come in, and the concept of content articles will fade away?
I don't think so. Will we see accelerated consumption of video content? Certainly, yes, and we are already seeing accelerated consumption of audio content, but content in text will never go out of fashion, like wristwatches will not go out of fashion. There's a comfort with it. So I'm not worried about the next 5 years, but is my daughter, who's 16 years old, and we tend to be dismissive of youngsters, saying they're not serious, but their worldview is brilliant. The sources of news could be reels. But their worldview of many things that we didn't have at their age. They never consume text voraciously. They will not. But we still have a large population which has grown up on text. That will come back, and we are seeing evidence of textual consumption coming back in some form or the other. So it's here to stay, is my view, like wristwatches are here to stay.
Got it. Here's a question for you, Naresh. And this is from Sudeep. How can news organizations adapt to changing consumer preferences for news consumption? Which is, can you give me what I like and don't just give me everything, was the question that Sudeep is referring to.
So, and that's increasingly becoming possible with especially things like AI. You can personalize something for readers. It's something I'm a little skeptical about. Because like I said, in order for democracy to thrive, you need a broad base of information and knowledge. So for instance, if the algorithm were to track me, it would give me only information about 1930s jazz, the best cycling routes in Bombay, and not so much else. And so if there was a virus that was beginning to make people sick in China, I would have no idea about it. And so we have to figure out how we balance these needs of individual interest, but also just a broad base of knowledge that readers need to survive.
Can I just add, one of the fascinating things I've noticed after joining Google is their approach to different surfaces, right? So if you take the news experience, you have Google search, where someone queries news, and then you have news.google.com, where someone actually goes and sees what publishers are publishing, right? And then you have YouTube, where... So I also think that...
Sorry, Durga, if you can speak into the mic.
Sorry. There is always, I think in most of these things, the push and the pull, and I know I'm making this point again, but an editorial newsroom or a newsroom that's gathering has to push to their audience. And a person who is a seeker of news will also always have to query and search and seek the news, right? So I just cannot see a future where the two are not always sort of tied to the hip in some manner or the other.
Got it. Thank you. So by show of hands, how many of you have seen the movie Kantara? Based by show of hands. Kantara, is that right? That's about 3/4. Very impressive. It's a Kannada movie. Could have been translated in Malayalam. The same kind of a thing even in Tamil Nadu, where I come from, quite a large population of people have actually seen the Kannada version. And that happened only because somebody happened to go see that movie and then came and raved about it, either on social media or in real life. And then people didn't want to miss out on it. They went and saw it either in the theater or on OTT. So the point here is that recommendations from people you like or people you trust has a huge impact on the virality of any information. Do you see that being built into news organizations? If so, how?
Yeah, sure. Yeah, so see, I mean, like with any other business, you know, word of mouth helps us. You know, if you introduce a feature, someone tweeting about it, or you know, an influencer. I mean, we see. I mean, there's the other side to it. Actually, we see a lot of influencers on Instagram talking about something, and you see at the bottom, right, with a small you know, credit to Moneycontrol. But the point I'm trying to say is that, you know, there is. When there is, especially where you have a direct relationship with your audience and you continue to do things, improve things, your workflow, your storytelling for them, they're surely going to, that is going to, you know, travel by word of mouth. They're going to tell their family members. You know, we keep getting examples. You know, one of our favorite stories is about when Nykaa was, you know, was about a list, actually. You know, all the family members were, you know, gathered around. And, you know, they, I mean, like, you know, like a television, they were looking at the Moneycontrol app. What is our pro research team? What do they have to say about it? So that's the kind of relationship that you build with your audience, and that will always serve the media organization very well.
Got it. Thank you.
I think while individual pieces of content, you do multiple things to get them. But what really gives you recommendation is how you build the brand. Mm. How consistent is your brand? What are the values of your brand? And if that is built strongly, those values attach to every single piece of content and they tend to travel better. So I would think of recommendation from outside. Forget the engines were built to recommend content for readers. Outside recommendation, word of mouth is built at a brand level than at a level of individual pieces of content. It's not so much about Kantara, but it's about Hambale. Hmm. Hambale films are there. And they have a good run now. And the next movie that Hambale makes, you will go and check it out because it's a Hambale movie. That is the role of the brand. And I think all our effort should be, and investment should be, in strengthening that brand, because every piece of content takes something from the brand.
No, so, I mean, again, like 10 years ago, it was really, really hard to get your first million users, right? Today, it is not hard to get your first 3 or 5 million users. And that is credit to, I think, such improved discoverability, the number of users who've come online, the people who are willing to give things a shot, share with each other. So there's also like a good, I think, trajectory that sharing between communities has built, right? So I think when something is new, the velocity you will get from sharing, I don't think, or you know, any form of these platform discoveries, I don't think it's met by anything else, right? But once you cross that sort of initial stage, what you do, you know, as a collection of the people who work within that brand, or as, you know, not giving up the momentum on what you've sort of doubled down on, right? Either as a beat or as a series of stories or as a feature. I mean, Moneycontrol, right? Like, they were the first brand who had users spending 45 minutes per visit. I have never seen numbers like that. I was lucky enough to work on that brand. And to date, right? I mean, building 600K plus subscribers is huge. So I think that kind of, and they had a killer feature, right? They had a portfolio that just people loved and they'd never let it go. So I think that kind of early mover addiction and stickiness, I think those fundamental principles haven't changed that much.
Got it. Thank you. So right now the test match is going on between India and Australia. And if you took a look at it either on your Hotstar app or on TV, one thing you will notice is this, while the match is going on, it's the stands are very fairly empty, almost like 3/4. But the game is still watched a lot. So I want to compare that with between long format content, which is the equivalent of a test match, which is like very well-researched, a deep dive analysis. And then in the morning, we spoke about the attention span of a goldfish, where just give me the crux, just give me the news, I'm done with it. Don't bore me to death. Just give me, in 5 seconds, can you tell me the news in shots, for example. So where do you see this balancing between? Will long-form content continue to survive in an age of disappearing attention?
Should I take that? Yeah. So, yeah, I just spoke about how the Ken, right? I mean, they were writing about long form. They moved to newsletters. I think there is an audience for both, right? There is always an audience which prefers what you just said. You know, Axios example is very famous. They give a snapshot of a story in 3-4 bullet points with context. There is Morning Brew, which is essentially a curation of what normally would be a long-form article and explaining it in very simple terms for its audience. So there is, Axios has its audience, the Morning Brew has an audience, and I'm sure there is an overlap between those two. Someone who subscribes to Axios is also subscribing to Morning Brew. So that it's about a media company, you know, finding those preferences in their audiences who would want to read a short capsule of a story with context, and those who have the time to want to have a better, deeper understanding of a particular sector or a particular topic.
Thank you, Binoy. Do you want to go for it, Navaneeth?
I think both have a role and both will exist. But the fact is, whether it's short form or long form, you have to do it extremely well. Short form doesn't mean a lazy approach to content. Both have to be done very well. And in my view, short form enlarges the top end of the funnel. Long form builds subscription revenue because people are willing to. And the content should be good. So for instance, if I were to use an analogy from science, short form gives you eyeballs and hence advertising. So your approach to science in short form would be like Stephen Hawking. Your approach to science for the subscription business would be like Einstein. Both will coexist.
So just two things. I think, you know, Delhi, Kotla was empty even 15 years ago for a test match, and it's still empty for a test match. So I think it's only in Bangalore, Madras, and Bombay that you'll see test match cricket being watched. It always was, and it always, I think, will be. So my biases aside, you know, I remember when I was part of this startup called Juggernaut, and there were about 20 engineers that were working with me. And they were all in a startup, and none of them read books, right? And I would be like, you know, how do I get you guys to understand the value of this? And then I realized that it was, in fact, I who was being short-sighted or snobbish about the format. All these young guys, I'm sorry I'm saying guys because it was predominantly men at that point, later two women engineers joined us, but they had 20 tabs open. They read no less than anyone. They were not special. I mean, they were excellent specialists. They were as hungry for knowledge as anyone else. They just didn't read books the way I read it. So I think I'd also park some kinds of snobbery to do with formats we are accustomed to and we grew up with, and perhaps also look at the way people seek knowledge, information, and expertise the way they might do so, right? I don't think there's only one way to do that.
Got it. So we heard the bell ring. We have about 2.5 minutes. I want to take each one of you, take a few seconds and let me know, look into the future. Who is your, you can't mention your own organization, apart from your organization, who do you look up to in the news space and why?
Before somebody else has the same answer. New York Times. For the way in which they've truly built today a reader first revenue model on top of reader first journalistic model they ever had. They always had. So New York Times for me.
New York Times. Okay.
Fortunately, he's taken my answer. But yeah, the New York Times has been fantastic because they do not compromise journalistic values. They put a lot of resources into sending people around the world to tell a single story, even as they have figured out additional sources of revenue. Recipes is now one of the reasons that, one of the things that drives their subscriptions. Wordle is another, or their whole bouquet of games. And so they've really been innovative in the way they do their journalism and in the way they run their business side.
Fantastic.
Yeah, sure. So I'm a big fan of Axios because to branch out from Politico and then to do something which no one else is doing, to create a unique product. I mean, whatever you might be a big fan of Smart Brevity or not, but to think about a format which would be widely received. And not just be done with just the newsletter, they continue to innovate, they continue to build new products. So I'm a big fan of Axios, and I'm not sure if you know of a site called Punch Bowl in the US. They cover the Capitol Hill. So it's a very competitive field. There is obviously Politico, there is obviously the Washington Post, there is the Hill. And Punch Bowl, very small team, but they are there. They catch senators in the train and they quickly put out the news. So they knew what is the thinking in the senator's mind. And for that, there's a huge fan base for that actually. So companies like that are trying out new things and are really essential, becoming essential to a community of readers. That's remarkable.
Fantastic. Durga, do you have anything to add?
No. So I was just going to say that. I respect most companies that are trying to change. I think all news
brands. You got to name one.
No. So I'll give you an example, right? So Scroll has been known for lots of text content that they've done, but they've actually have this phenomenal executive producer of video, Sanmuta, who's come up with this brilliant idea to use ML for short form video, and Google's actually funding that program, right? So I really feel like for me, the quality I admire is change. All these brands, New York Times, Washington Post, they've all stultified over time. They've reinvented, they will stultify again. And so will all of us. But I think if you don't have blinkers on and you're able to build a culture that really creates, somebody to be sparked up and bright and innovative, I think I admire all these brands that are doing phenomenal stuff and trying hard at changing their journalism and business as well.
Got it. Thank you, Durga. Thank you. And that's it to the panel. Let's give them a big round of applause. It's phenomenal. Thank you so much.